We're going to start with the spoon. Now, I have about three or four really valid instruments and sounds that you can make with a spoon alone. Now, if you take a string and tie the string around the handle of a spoon, any spoon or fork in your kitchen, and this will work for other things that I'll show you. You wrap the string around your index fingers and put the fingers in your ear and bang the spoon up against a counter or something. You hear the biggest church bell in your ear, in your head, that you can imagine. Now, what I tell percussionists is if you wrap the string around a microphone, you get to hear exactly what that sound is like in your head. And by tying multiple spoons or forks around a piece of string, you get almost chordal sounds. Now, every fork and spoon in your kitchen gets a different sound. Here is a ladle. You do the same thing. You tie that string around the handle of the ladle and wrap a little bit of the string around your index fingers and put that in your ear. Oh, that's a wonderful sound. I wish you could hear that. And you will hear that when you try it at home. I'll put a larger spoon on the microphone, and this is what the percussionist can do in the studio, so you can hear what this sounds like. That just sounds, you can hear a little bit of it out here, but with a microphone or within your ear, you really hear an interesting, wonderful sound. Now, other things that you can tie a string around to get an interesting sound would be the little shelf out of your refrigerator. You just tie a piece of string on each end of this refrigerator shelf, and you can either bang it this way to hear an interesting sound, or while you have this in your ear, you can have someone else just run across something this way, and you almost hear like a harp sound. You can tell exactly what it's going to sound like. So let's tie the string around the shelf from your refrigerator and put that around the microphone so you can hear what this is like. Now, when you hear that, I think you're going to really be surprised how wonderful that sounds. Now, that's a shelf out of your refrigerator. We can also take the grate out of the oven and do the same thing. Put that in your ear and bang that against a counter, or have someone get a pencil or a spoon handle and run across it that way. You hear a wonderful harp sound. I know you're going to be very surprised when you hear how wonderful these sound. Now, there are a couple of other very authentic, interesting sounds that we can make with spoons. One of them is if you put the eating part of the spoon against your cheek and then hit it with the backside of the spoon against the backside of the one that's on your cheek, and opening and closing your mouth changes the pitch. And you actually can play melodies. So that's what you can do with that. Now, what we do in the studios, especially when someone is stalking around and the composer will say, you have 2 bars to make some interesting sounds of mystery. Someone is stalking around in the jungle or something. With a wooden spoon, we do this sound a lot. So we've used that a lot in the studio. In fact, I could tell you that we used this on King Kong just recently. Now, another interesting thing you can do with spoons is by holding a spoon between your index finger this way and playing them on your knee. You play one side on your knee and this side on your the palm of your hand. A small child is not able to hold the spoons between his index fingers because his fingers are too small and they don't make a space. They might be too close. So what you can do in that case is to tie, in this case I have a cork in here. You tie a cork in the center with a little tape around it, and he doesn't have to, or he or she doesn't have to put their finger in the handles of the spoon. They can grab it this way and play. And here's somebody had an interesting idea to bend the spoons and weld them together to make a little space in between to do the same thing. And we were talking also about the spoons and forks in the last session. I just want to show you how elaborate some people have gotten. This is a fork that's all been bent up and made as a handle with a spoon in the middle, a spoon section in the middle flattened out, and a little wind chime made out of that. Here's another one where the fork has been bent and the spoons have been flattened out. Listen how wonderful that is for a wind chime. Now, as you can see, there's a bunch of different things that we make wind chimes out of. And what I do is I save every broomstick or mop handle and I cut them at different lengths just to keep them ready when I come up with a wind chime. And what we do is we drill holes approximately one inch apart all the way across, and then I tie something around it, and that's the beginning of a wind chime or the handle for a wind chime to hold it. Now, the secret of wind chimes so that they don't tangle is to start the first row as evenly as you possibly can and the last row as evenly as you possibly can. And it's more difficult for it to tangle when you do it that way. An example would be this one. These are orange juice caps. Now what we do is you take a nail and bang a little hole on the top and on the bottom and use fishing tackle to tie the top, and you can either stop here and then put another piece or go right through. This fishing tackle goes right through all the way to the bottom, but you can see this first row is as even as possible across here and across the bottom so that it won't tangle up. It's easier not to tangle if you do it that way. Here's one we made with peanut butter, jelly, mustard, every kind of jar top you can imagine. And again, it's hard for them to tangle up when you start the first row evenly and the last row evenly. And I don't have it here with me today, but also you can make them with paint lids. If you can imagine how large the paint lid of a gallon paint can lid is, you start collecting all of your different lids, and you'll get enough to make a wonderful wind chime. The wild thing is that you don't know what it's going to sound like until you start tying them all together. You could hit just one particular thing, like here, here's some screws. Now you hit a screw and it may not sound too interesting, but when you put a bunch of them together, now believe it or not, on a microphone, that's such a wonderful sound, and we use this a lot in the studios for different subtle sounds that we need. You can go to the key shop, and usually the key man, he has so many rejects, he's not supposed to give them to you because I guess someone could probably use them, but if they're a reject, they didn't work well on the door anyway. So you can ask them for them, tell them you're doing a project, and in most cases they will give you some keys. And by the way, this will play in any key. Here's one we put together with prime rib bones. And we've used every one of these sounds in the studios. There's never enough different variety of sounds that you can have in your collection of percussion instruments or just to have around the home. Now here's one we made with just these are slides from microscopes. And what we did was we just painted them with some kind of glass paint. So we save every kind of thing that might work to hang these things with. I'll show you a few more. Here's one we made with just pieces of wood left over from a fence that we built. And we just painted them a little bit so you get a little interesting color with them. Now you know what these are? These are what you fix your divot with on the golf course. And I just thought, when you hit one or two of these things, they never sound, and you can't tell what they're going to sound like until you start hanging with the fishing tackle. You can hear how wonderful they sound. Drummers should never throw away their old drumsticks. These are old drumsticks that either broke or the one got lost out of the pair. We're just putting those together. Chemical tubes that they use in the laboratory, we just put a bunch of these together. These are the little bottles that they used to serve on the airplane. And if you can see, this one is blue in color. What I did at one time was to put artificial color in all of these bottles and hang this up against a window. And how lovely to have the sunshine on all these bottles with different colors of water in there. So you might want to consider that when you make your wind chime. That's one of the most beautiful sounds, isn't it? Now, I've also made one with wrenches. Now, when you clank one wrench against the other, it doesn't sound good at all. But if you hang your wrenches with fishing tackle and play them this way, they're louder and more beautiful than these are. We use tin can shakers in the studio. A shaker in Spanish is called chocayo, and it's used quite often in Latin American music. And we make different size cans to get different pitches and timbres of sound. And what we use inside the can is either rice, unpopped popcorn, bird seed, sand, or little rock pebbles. The different things that you use give you a different sound. And here are an assortment of different cans. This is a Sapporo beer can. It's quite large. Here's a soup can. These are tomato. One is tomato juice. Actually, both of them are. I thought one of them would be tomato paste. Here's our coffee can. I think we have something really light in here, but when you have to play slow, you like to have a little bit of a larger can so you have space to go front and back. And here's our Band-Aid can. So you can see how the different size cans and the different materials that you put in the can give you a different sound. And what you do is you just put in, after you have an empty container, you put in just a little less than a handful of material in it, and you then close the top with some tape. Is the easiest way to do it. Now there's even some smaller devices that you could use for shakers. Here's the Tic Tac container with a lot of the Tic Tacs missing. And we even used the little film cans and put some rice in them to get real subtle sounds. Or here's a cigar tube. Very subtle, but there are a lot of times when we're recording music, they want a real subtle sound. And speaking of subtle, how about a little bit of creamer? Now, besides the little shakers this way, there are different other ways that you can shake things. These are the legs that the women buy and put their stockings in. And I found that by putting 31 BBs, I don't know why that number works better than any other number, but 31 BBs in here, when you give it one twirl, it stays shaking for quite a while. And it really feels good in your hand too, because the BBs are just twirling around. Some other shakers are like beer. These are beer cans, and we put some handles on them. Or you can. Happy New Year! Here's a set of maracas we made out of the toilet bowl balls that are inside the inner workings of the toilet. And these are brass, so they get a really interesting sound. Another set of maracas can be made out of the little lemon juice containers and put pencils on the bottom of them and some rice material or bird seed inside. How about these? These are the tops of chain link fences. There's an instrument in Brazil called caxixi, spelled C-A-X-I-X-I, pronounced caxixi, and they're used with an instrument called the birimbá, which is a bow that gets an interesting sound. A couple of other things that we can do with cans, these are, or tin, These are the little cookie molds to make little cakes. And we found that because they're corrugated on the bottom, they get a really interesting sound. We're going to demonstrate some metallic sounds now, starting with the spurs. These are spurs from the back of cowboy boots. They make wonderful little finger cymbals. We use these a lot. Now, what I've discovered is brass. Any brass object usually makes a wonderful sound. You can get some great sounds with just hitting on brass objects. So just to give you an idea what we could do if we just had a few pieces of brass laid around. This would have to be laid down this way. And lay it on something soft. Now, I'm sure your parents wouldn't appreciate your banging on their good pieces of brass if they have some dishware or knickknacks or something made of brass. But consider this, stainless steel mixing bowls. We get two distinctly wonderful sounds with stainless steel mixing bowls. If we hit them this way, they sound like beautiful bells, and they ring really a long time. Setting this some up here. Or with a hard stick. But on their backside, they get this marvelous boinging sound. And we use these in Planet of the Apes. Jerry Goldsmith was the composer, and he said, we're having a chase where the apes are chasing the humans, and I want a really unusual sound because it's the first time you see the apes and they're on horseback chasing the humans that are also on horseback. And we had to come up with an interesting sound. So I hit the bottoms of these things. To me, this is one of the most marvelous instruments because you can't hurt them. They're stainless steel, and they're found around your home, and they make, like I say, beautiful bells when hit this way, or this marvelous boinging sound on the back. And I've been trying to find different kinds of boinging sounds, so here's a bedpan. Here's a Coca-Cola gong. Now, this in conjunction with the mixing bowls, and here's also a cafeteria food tray that the Army supplies to the servicemen. You get different sounds out of all of this. I've been experimenting with different kinds of springs. Here's an interesting sound. Now, this is the most ingenious of all sounds that I've got. This was made by, I did a concert tour with George Harrison, and we had 15 musicians from India playing with us with Ravi Shankar. And the percussionists, there were two percussionists from Bombay, India that came with them. And this is a finger cymbal, a saw blade, so it's kind of spring steel. And this is a chime that comes out of a clock chime. And he put this together, and it's the most marvelous sound I've ever heard. It almost sounds like the jaw harp, if you know what the jaw harp sounds like. And a lot easier to play and a lot longer sustain. So if you can see how that's done, it's just a piece of saw blade or any piece of spring steel with a clock chime. You can go to a clock shop and find these clock chimes, because incidentally, these clock chimes played on a timpani sound marvelous. You could do them on a timpani, but this one was put with a little cup under your hand. So you get that nice boinging sound. Here's something else we can do with cans. Now, before we continue, I just want to tell you, a lot of the instruments that percussionists use have mallets. Now, these are the balls that the girls play jacks with, and boys too probably. What we did was we just stuck knitting needles through the ball to make mallets out of them, so that when you have these lids, this lid is closed at the bottom, but if you open the lids, you can make little drums out of these as well. And this is what we use for sticks, or just a dowel, and we wrap string around it. Just giving you an idea of how to make simple mallets. I brought some professional mallets to hit on some of the things we're going to be demonstrating. But to make your own mallets from things around the home, these are a simple way to do them. And I brought that up because I want to play on this one. What we did here, this is a potato chip can. And we opened it up and bent it, and then we banged nail holes all in this thing so that we banged the nails from this side, and it becomes real corrugated. And we put a piece of wood to hold it, and you can make a real guido, is the Latin name for a scratcher. And of course, we can also play on our cheese grater. Another interesting sound. These are oil can poppers. And if you bring them close to your mouth, you can hear how you change the pitch. We use these for suspense a lot in the movies too. And even a larger one. By putting your hand near the opening, you change the pitch. There's another scratcher device by taking a can and putting a spring on it. I've got two separate springs here so you can get two different sounds. Or and what's wrong with making bells out of cans? You just bang two little holes on the top and put a string through with a nail inside. Now this is an instrument found in India called the Goop Gooby. And what we did was we put a plastic or a nylon string found with ukuleles or guitar string and put a button at the end of it so that once you put it through, it won't come through. Of course, we got excited here and we kind of went through the thing, but by changing, pulling on this thing and plucking on it, you can change the pitch. And we were talking about making mallets. These are the super balls that when the kids drop them on the floor, they really go crazy. The reason for that is because there's such a condensed amount of rubber put into this little ball that if you were to just take this teriyaki stick, which these are, and puncture it through the super ball, these are called super balls, they would crumble like a piece of bread. So what we usually do is we drill a hole and then stick the teriyaki stick in some glue and put that into the hole and wait till it dries. Now these work on everything. We're going to work them on some things later, but just so you can hear, even on the table. And the size of the ball gives you the different pitches. And here's a big one. These we used on Planet of the Apes. There you have it. One day, the Girl Scouts came to our door, and instead of selling cookies, they were selling these little bottle cap shakers. And what they did was they drilled a hole in the bottle cap a little larger than the nail. Then they drove the nails through these little sticks to get this nice little sound. And you can play them on your knee. So I just thought, how interesting and how ingenious. And I thought I would try to make them out of something a little larger than the bottle caps. So I took the jar tops off of wine containers, the gallon wine containers, or these could have been apple juice, I don't remember. But we did the same thing. We drilled holes a little larger than the nail and put them in a shaker to make kind of a tambourine. Then we did make one out of the bottle caps. In the old days, they used to make things like this and they call them sistrums. They used sistrums in Egypt and they made them out of little different jingles, but the bottle caps get a really interesting sound. And all we did here was to put a piece of wire across this little thing, and we found this thing, and of course I put a couple down here just for looks. And then we made some out of the little tambourine jingles. So there's no end to the different things that you can come up with when you're trying to make some instruments or interesting sounds. Some of them are a little more difficult to make and take a little bit of work. But still, they're interesting and fun to do. Now, these are the cables that the phone company, I believe, use. And they were doing some work around this office building, and they were throwing these away. And I looked at them and said, what great castanets! Because they just keep bouncing right back open and they just get that wonderful sound. Now, speaking of castanets, you could make kind of a castanet sound with your nutcrackers as well. And you can build up some muscle as you're doing it. Because they just keep bouncing back open. And if there's some sandpaper somewhere around the house, you just put a little bit on a piece of block. Now, we've been experimenting with balloons. And we put a balloon over the film can, and if you just put your mouth half on it and blow, makes a great whistling sound. And I'm experimenting with different sizes of it to see if we can get different pitches. So those are interesting sounds. There's a lot of times when we need to demonstrate or make the sound of horses' hoofs, or temple blocks as they're called. And one interesting way would be to take the coconut, a regular coconut, after you've eaten the good meat inside and drink the juice, to get a couple of pair and just play on them. We use those a lot in the studio. Now, this may look very curious to you. This is the little gas pipe that sits in back of your stove. And that makes an interesting sound. But because this is corrugated, the wild thing is when you blow into it, you get the full spectrum of the natural harmonic sound. And you can blow or suck inward, and you don't have to ever stop playing. In other words, you can blow or inhale and still get sounds out of it. Now, it's not too readily that you're going to find this unplugged in your home, but what you might find is a couple of extra pieces of corrugated pipe that fit under your faucet in your sink. This is not the piece that fits under your faucet in the sink. This is a microphone extension goodie. And this also gets a great sound. We're asked in the studios to play all kinds of different sounds for rhythms. And these are just little broom whisks. Now there's an instrument from Hawaii called the pu'ili sticks that the Hawaiian girls usually play, and they play them on their shoulder and they snap them together like this, and they're made of bamboo. And in most climates, bamboo cracks and doesn't last too long. But what these are grape stakes that you would hang in or stick in the ground to hang tomato plants or something like that. You could find them in most nurseries. And what I did was I put a piece of masking tape around the bottom of them to hold them together, but the ones in the center would fall out even though you had tape around them. So we put a little bit of silicone inside here so that the inner ones wouldn't come out, and it makes a great sound. We use this a lot for backbeats in playing rock and roll songs and stuff when they're looking for a real heavy sound. This comes off of a tree. I don't know the name of the tree, but that's where we got these. And these, when we need to have the sound of a rattlesnake, that's when we use these pods. They're pods that the beads inside or the seeds inside always loosen up after they're dry. And there are some in California, and I'm sure in other states, so you should look for a tree that may have these long things growing and wait till they dry and you get this great rattlesnake sound. Of course, these are lava rocks from Hawaii, but you can use any two Aggie stones. And actually, they play rhythms with these in Hawaii. So we've used these a lot when we have to play Hawaiian music. I just thought this was an interesting thing. This is the egg cutter, the hard-boiled egg cutter. And if you listen, it's almost a nice... sounds like a little toy piano. Now this, we don't have these snails where we come from, but these snails come from Hawaii, and someone thought of this ingenious idea of putting two together, and these shells just sound wonderful when you put the stick in between them. Here's a real interesting sound. This is a spring on a gallon jug, and by hitting the spring, you really hear a ricochet sound. You want to hit it with something hard like the back end of a spoon or a piece of metal. Now here's something that was invented by a fine percussionist from India, Srilak Gurtu. He's a wonderful tabla and drummer percussionist, and he came up with this idea. This is just a piece of PVC pipe, and he put a little skin on the end of it. It's a plastic head on here with a spring, and listen to how wonderful this sounds. Now this may take a little more work. This is just a cardboard tube. And this is a little stick with some resin on it. And of course, you tie a string around this little cardboard tube where there's paper on it. And by moving your hand up and down, you get these wild sounds. Or you can shake it. I believe we have another one or two here. Here's a larger one. Sounds like some angry bees.